calibrated means is a measure. So what I'll be talking about today is some of the things that I feel like are a measure of God's love. So this is a favorite saying of mine, that love is a culture of its own. Amen? It doesn't submit to any other cultures. It is the culture that everything else should come under, in my humble opinion. So one good thing about calibration or a measure is the thing with Jesus is that it's not unattainable. Amen? We're living in New Testament days where we have a Savior. So the standard or the measure that Jesus is calling us to in our love walk is not unattainable. Amen? And if there's somewhere in our thinking that thinks that it is, perhaps we need a tweak or an adjustment. Otherwise, he wouldn't have sent his son. Amen? So I just want to read to you from 1 Peter 3 in the Passion. It says, the heading is love one another. Now this is the goal, to live in harmony with one another and demonstrate affectionate love, sympathy, and kindness towards other believers. Let humility describe who you are as you dearly love one another. I have a sign on my desk, a version of that that I write, that I keep. It says, let humility define me. That's the four words that I often keep on all my desks. Let humility define me. That's how I want to be known. It goes on to say, never retaliate when someone treats you wrongly, nor insult those who insult you, but instead respond by speaking a blessing over them, because a blessing is what God promised to give you, for the scriptures tell us. Whoever wants to embrace true life and find beauty in each day must stop speaking evil and hurtful words and never deceive in what they say. Always turn from what is wrong and cultivate what is good. Eagerly pursue peace in every relationship, making it your prize. Sounds a bit easy, doesn't it? Look at that. Eagerly pursue peace, making it your prize in every relationship. Well, who knows that some relationships are easier to pursue peace than others? That's true, isn't it? Just saying. Anyway, I'm sharing something today that I didn't know that I was sharing until this morning. And you'll be pleased with me. I didn't even argue with God about it, so it was good news. I felt like, yeah, it was progress for me. Anyway, I felt like that as part of the leadership in this ministry and as we head into 2021, that for me, that I should start the year being fairly transparent and quite accountable to you. Because one of my messages is that we may have all different positions, but we're all in this together. Amen? It's not me, you, it's not this pulpit is better than the supermarket pulpit. They're just different. Amen. So I felt like the Lord wanted me to share some of my personal stuff over the last couple of months. So I was thinking about 2020, as we go into 21. And for me, 2020 was one of my better years. Now, I know that that's not always popular, and I know that for a lot of people it's been a very difficult time, but the year 2020 was absolutely one of my better years. I mean, the COVID, when COVID came, I live in a place that we're well removed from the majority of what's going on and still are. And I feel very blessed and very fortunate daily to be in this space away from it. It also brought us some relief with the financial packages through our business, which was unexpected. And, you know, you could say that that may have been an answer to prayer in a way that only God could do. For us, but when I'm saying that, I don't want to downgrade anybody at all who has been affected by COVID, because I know for a lot of people it's been trauma and tragedy, but I'm just speaking for me. I saw an answer to a 15-year prayer last year, something I've been praying for 15 years, and I saw an answer, which I was very thankful for. I got extended employment in the space that I work in. My health improved last year, not really sure how, but it just did. And I had plenty of quality time with my family and time away. So as a general statement, if I look back at the year, 2020 was okay for me. But it wasn't without a battle. So to get those things that I saw, I had been fighting for some time. So, you know, the 15-year prayer that I saw, I might have been fighting answered. I might have been fighting that for 20. Amen? So behind last year, there's backstories to every single situation of how I got there. But some of the things that did happen in 2020 that weren't so great had the potential to actually take out the 26 years that I'd spent serving God. So even though I had all those great things happen, there were one or two things happen that actually, if they had been left unattended and love hadn't been measured to them, they actually had the potential to take me right out of the game. Not even in a drama, the truth of my heart. So, and some of that was demonic, some of that was straight demonic, and some of that was people inflicted towards me. So either way, I'm responsible for the level and the measure of love that I apply to those situations. Are we in agreement with that? So I'm committed to learning to see what love looks like for me, mostly. Anyway, so I felt like the Holy Spirit wanted me to share some things that I've had personally just in the last few months. So out of nowhere, which is probably not nowhere, I've had increased anxiety. So if you know my story, I was 35 before I realized that you don't wake up in a fetal position with that feeling of melancholy and anxiety on you. And I know you can say, well, that's ridiculous, you should know. But if you don't know, you don't know. So I'm nearly 55. So we're talking, it was 20 years ago when I realized that. And around 20 years ago that stopped happening, maybe 18 or 19 years ago. So I've been free from that for a really long time, right? But random about, and occasionally it will still come, but just about 3 months ago, I started waking up like that. And I'm like, well, I'm not really appreciating this because I'm enjoying 2020. And so I just noticed it and it was okay. And, you know, I just did what I knew to do with it. This isn't who I am. I knew the scriptures. I knew what to do with it. And I left it alone. And it sort of came and went and came and went. And it's not really any big deal. But then there started to be some more things adding to it, which I call demonic rewinds. So if you're not familiar with that term, what I call that is it's something that comes to you on repeat of something that hasn't happened but could happen. And it's one of those things that taps into something that has happened and it reminds you of that and then adds the demonic to it. Like example, this is not one because I don't actually want to tell you what they were, but because it would not be good for you or me. But one of the things could be this, like example, if I saw my husband walking slow or walking with a limp, right? Okay, well, I don't know, maybe as a sore leg, I don't know. But if I saw that, then this thought would come and it would be along the lines of, remember 30 years ago he got run over on his motorbike? Remember he got run over and he broke his back? And remember what the report said, that he was going to be in a wheelchair by now? And if that happens, this is going to happen and this is going to happen. And actually, remember 3 years ago he fell off the ladder and he did break his back? Anyway, you got that? So just these crazy little things in a few different topics, mainly to do with my family, started happening on top of the little bit of anxiety and the little bit of demonic rewindy things. But what was interesting with the demonic rewind things are I find that it's always got a little bit of truth mixed with a lie, because the truth was he did get run over on a motorbike. He did break his back. The medical report did say that. The natural truth, but of course God had another truth, but then the demonic adds those lies. Do you see what I mean? Can you relate to that? Because then when you're in a space where you're not thinking clearly, you're like, is that true or not? Like is actually, could that be God? Is God trying to warn me? Do I need to pray for him more? And yeah, it's not very good. Like it's just not good. So I've got that going on, which is not bad either. I also felt I also felt this attraction to withdraw, to isolate. And you know I'm all about vulnerability and being connected. So even when I don't like it, but I knew it was not right. So I had to just work that little bit harder to stay connected. Because one of the things I've been working on quite intensely for the last 5 years is this thing about self-awareness and living awakened. So I was sort of able to draw aside and see what was going on. Something else that I noticed, I saw some anger in myself that I literally had not seen for 10 years. I mean, like, I'm going to pin you to that wall sort of anger. Like, not I'm angry you didn't do the dishes. I mean, like, super angry. And it actually bothered me because I hadn't seen that in such a long time. And there was an incident that happened that triggered that, but I knew what to do. I went and got communion. I literally fell to my knees. I went and got communion and I put some worship music on. Probably it took 4 hours, maybe five. And I just had to stay in that place and work out actually what that whole thing was. And all these little incidences were not major. But who knows when you have a whole pile of little things unattended that love has not been applied to. Not a very good mix. Another thing that was this is great, this is super cheery, and I'm just like, I knew there would be no point just arguing with God about sharing this because it just wasn't going to be very good, but he was really beautiful, like driving to church this morning, and I said to the Lord, well, Peter was driving, but I was in the car, and I said to the Lord, I hope you're pleased, I hope this turns out okay, and automatically I heard his voice, he said, I'm already pleased. Does that sound like God? I'm like so thankful, like I'm already pleased. So another thing that I noticed that had been increasing in my headspace was the rules had started to slip back in. And for someone like me that has lived under very harsh self-demonic rules for decades and decades, I didn't really see that coming because I thought that I was well protected from them. It was interesting because they weren't food rules, because that was where a lot of my things were. They weren't food rules. They were things about other things about where you could go and what you couldn't do, and things about you can't do this a certain way. Like you are. In fact, here was one today. I think today actually it was. I was getting dressed, and I heard this voice say, "You can't wear that white watch." Like, I'm like, I can, do you know, like, and so even though that in itself is not a big deal, I'm just trying to give you a picture of how mindsets work, because often if we are not working in a space or we don't have people in our circle that are prepared to share those things with you, we think sometimes it's just us and we might be going crazy or a little bit less than that. So the rules had sort of set back in. Do you know, one of the other things was you can't work these sort of hours. You have to work between 9 and 5. No, I actually don't, because that's not the sort of work that I do. But that thing kept saying, like, you know, and if you don't, your value won't be in that and you won't have done this and that. But that actually isn't true, because my creativity works best at 2, 3 and 4 in the morning. And so just these little niggly sort of things that were coming. And one of the other things I noticed was that I had pseudo self-care. I thought that I was really self-caring and I wasn't. So when I actually went back and had a look at my time and my space, the time frames that I needed for self-care were not what they should have been. Amen. So now that I've spilled my story to you, I had a great 2020. But I actually really did. But it's a cool story. So I've sort of processed all that and noticed those things, and some of those things are still there, not the anxiety, but that demonic rewind thing is still there, and the real thing is still a little bit. But like today when I heard that about the watch, I'm like, what? Do you know, because these are not ridiculous things. These are those rules and those voices that come. If you notice them and experience them, you'll notice that they're often not things like rob a bank today. Now you might get that from time to time, I'm not saying. But you'll notice they're this. There you go. No family member of mine over there. No. But you'll notice they're the small things, the small foxes that spoil the vine. Amen. So what I realized was in sharing all that with you, besides the fact that I smashed that thing of trying to isolate or disconnect, and the thing is, I don't have to tell you this because literally it's none of your business, so to speak, in a polite way. But if we're all in this together and we're trying to build something for a greater cause and a greater goal, which is this church and this community and this city, etc., etc., this is where it starts, on the inside. Amen. So if someone in the leadership would do it, then that might encourage that maybe someone else could. And it's a crazy thing, because even how ridiculous that story is about the watch, you might hear that when you're getting dressed or when you're turning at the traffic lights or when you're doing something else, and you'll just go, no, I can do that. Or I can choose this different product at the supermarket. I don't really care. Whatever your deal might be. So, but what I realized was that all those things, underneath all that, were chipping away at my identity. And that was the key for me in that last few months of last year. All those things were just slowly chipping away at what I'd spent 25 or 26 years to build. And I wasn't in any sort of depression or panic or anything. I was fine. But it was crazy how, standing back and putting those things in order, I can see them all, and super grateful to the Holy Spirit for showing them. But one of the things that I found was, see, I purposely surround myself with people that are like-minded and not like-minded. And one of the issues with doing that is the measure of the like-minded has to be stronger than the non-like-minded. Because you add those other chipping away things, and all of a sudden you're wondering where your standard and your measure might be. So I realized that besides the enemy, because some of those things, that happened were straight out demonic. I wrote this, that God was peeling back more of my protection mechanisms to reveal who I really am. See, for me, anger and rules were protective mechanisms for decades. Because if I'm angry, you'll stay away from me. Because you don't want to be near me, because it's not very pleasant, and nobody does that to themselves, right? Do you know? And if I have rules, then I have rules that keep me safe so that I can't allow anyone to get close. And I realized that even though I've come so far, that there's more work. Hallelujah. But there was some lining on that, because one of my other protective mechanisms was silence. And I realized that I've stopped doing that. For the most part, I'm able to communicate, hey, this is what I'm feeling. So there's victory in that. So that was really good. I feel like the Holy Spirit was asking me this, like, where is my trust at? While all these things were happening, where is my trust? Was my trust in my ability? Was my trust in my husband's faith? Or was my trust actually in God? All of it. The answer was all of it. Because some days I'm just relying on him, Peter. And other days I am relying on my own ability because I am capable in the natural. And other days I'm relying on God. But the goal is to move further and further to God. Amen? Less and less of me. So within this measure of love and this standard, see, and the problem is I feel like sometimes when we use standard of love, automatically we equate that to, I can never make that standard, because, you know, that's this big standard up here that I can't reach. But if we use measure, sometimes that's a more friendly word and people respond. You know, the measure of love rather than the standard of love. I don't know. Words are important. So within this measure of love, I always feel like there's a tension between two opposing opinions. So you've got a thought out here and a thought out here, and the measure of love is somewhere in the middle. So one of the things for me is, like, is speaking versus staying quiet. So speaking is over here. Staying quiet is over here, and somewhere in the middle you apply this measure of love and you find out what you should be doing in each situation, right? Because who knows, there's a time to say what you need to, and who knows that there's a time to just be quiet. Who knows that that's really hard to do when people are telling things that aren't true about you. But that goes back to that whole thing about allowing God to be your vindicator and do I actually trust him, or do I need my own protection mechanisms? So one of the things that I've noticed is, see, no voice incites anger for me. Not so much now, not really now at all. But that thing of never being able to have a voice, never feeling heard or being able to have a voice incites anger, versus when you don't speak up, or when you do speak up, it doesn't go very well. Because people don't always accept it. So then you've got to get yourself right back into a whole new measure of your identity and what that looks like, and make peace with the fact that, hey, I think God did want me to say something there. Yeah, it's an ongoing, just fabulous topic. So how about this one, trusting my decisions versus other decisions? So I'm really practicing, we're practicing trusting the decisions that we feel like the Holy Spirit's told us versus all the opposing opinions of what other people have told us. I just call it that tension between opposing opinions. So I watched a movie recently on Netflix called The Glass Castle. Has anyone seen it? Yes. Well, yes. There we go. Winnetta and Virginia. Well worth watching. Would that be true, ladies? Yeah, okay. Let me butcher it and give you my opinion of it. So it's a true story. It is a true story, but it's a story of some parents. The father was an alcoholic, and they raised their children, and the children went on to be four children went on to be successful, but they lived in poverty. You know, they didn't have clothes, they didn't have food, they lived in cars, they moved all the time, etc. But I found that one of them went on to be a New York writer, bestseller, actually, in real life, who wrote the story. But and it's called The Glass Castle because they were always building a glass castle that never got built. But one of the things that really affected me about it was that even though the parents were, we could say, not necessarily great parents, the father was a self-confessed alcoholic, gambled with the money, did all those things. Well, he did some good things too. Is that true? It's so true. And it was so freeing to see, as a parent of older children, but also just as a person, you know, who makes mistakes, that good can still come out of it. There was no God factor in it, none that I saw anyway. But it was very freeing to see that even in situations like that, that there were still relationships that were able to be salvaged, even through the high trauma and the high dysfunction. So, and I feel like that the only way that could happen is through love. They understood somehow through that, yeah, it's true, isn't it? Somehow through that chronic dysfunction of literally having nowhere to live for years and years on end and no food, they were able to gather together and keep, yeah. Anyway, well worth watching if you're up for it. But it's called The Glass Castle. But so I feel like that with love as a measure, he wants things in us exposed so that we can be all the things that he's designed us to be. Look, I don't have to tell you what's going on in the world today. You can turn on any news channel you like. So we'll just put that right there, because I'm staying away from that area for now. But here's a couple of thoughts from the scriptures about love as a measure. Love overcomes all things. All things. There's a way. Love covers a multitude of sins. Let love and kindness be the motivation behind all that you do. Faith works by love. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. I wrote here that you need faith to believe. Like, you need faith to believe that you can love, that measure's even a thing. So it just sort of goes around and round, doesn't it? And Peter and I were talking about it last night, and I was saying that you need a greater measure of love, or a greater measure of faith, to love certain people and in certain situations. And of course that was afforded to me as well. I'm not leaving me out of that. And then finally, faith, hope and love, but the greatest of these is love. It's such an important topic, and sometimes, you know, I feel like the scriptures that we know so well are just, okay, that's just that. God is love, that's beautiful. And love is patient, that's beautiful. but unless it's a practical outworking, you imagine if we took that scripture that I read this morning from 1 Peter 3 and we applied that to the unrest in the American political situation today, how that would change. And I'm not saying who's right or wrong, but can you understand if we took those principles and we actually applied them, or those they applied them, what that could look like? But, you know, the people that are in power today were people just like us. Just saying, they're not anyone different or special. We all started off at the same thing. In Proverbs 9, it actually talks about a promiscuous woman, but it's also a general statement as well. But I like it because there's a line in there and it says, a spirit named foolish. You don't want to look up what foolish means. It's a little bit depressing. Like idiotic or stupid. There we go. So a spirit named idiotic or stupid. But the scripture says this. There is a spirit named foolish who is boisterous and brash. She's seductive and restless. And she sits at the gateway to high places on her throne overlooking the city. She preaches to all who walk by her who are clueless as to what is happening. We're clueless to what is happening because there's a spirit of foolishness being preached to us and we don't even know. Now, for probably 2 years, I've been talking about living awakened from the pulpit, like living awakened unto God. But I don't want to be the person who the spirit of foolishness is preaching to and I actually don't even know because I'm just taking it in. I've got the news turned on and I think that's gospel, and I've got the Christian channel turned on and now I think that's gospel, and now I think the next thing's gospel, but who knows that there's some good and some right in the majority of them. And it takes somebody with the addition of the Holy Spirit to rightly divide what is happening. Amen? Otherwise, we are going to be those people who are just filled with a spirit of foolishness and believe everything that is. I really just want to give some examples, but I just can't because I don't want to start it. But anyway, you know, if you've turned the news on, you've seen it. So living awakened. So when you're clueless about self, you don't live awakened individually. And for me, the problem with that is then collectively we'll see the fruit, and it's what we're currently living in. So that's a big deal for me, and I feel like that's part of the reason that the Holy Spirit wanted me to be quite transparent with you about what happens in my mind on pretty much every day. But because what happens individually, if we don't deal with it, then becomes collective. Because the spirit of foolish is very loud. Amen? Really loud. Yep. Collectively, we'll see the fruit, and that's what we're currently living in. A couple of examples is the pandemic, okay, and I don't want to get into where the virus started, etc., etc., but I'm sure we've all seen people who don't want to do what they've been asked to do. Selfish, right? Sorry, like super selfish, but anyway, I'm sure I haven't done everything perfect either, but if you pay attention to the wrong news sources, you will be under a spirit of foolishness instead of under doing what you're meant to do, which is the laws of the land unto God. Amen? So just what we've seen people do in a pandemic, the racial demonstrations where people are actually just losing their lives physically. Whatever your take on it is, looting and stealing is not okay. It's just not okay. Whether it was done wrong or done right, taking people's stuff and bashing and murder is just not okay. At all. And then of course the Trump and the Biden thing. So, and somebody or a couple of people actually recently said, oh, those things don't affect us. Yes, they do. Yes, they do. I'll leave that there. Someone else, my brother can pick that up. Yes, they do. Anyway, couple of closing thoughts. So Deanne, whenever you're ready, that would be great. Please. Love is the measure that teaches us how to behave. So love is the measure in those scriptures that teaches us how to behave in a pandemic. It sets a standard for what we should do. It teaches us to put a mask on even when we think it's ridiculous. look, personally, I read a thing yesterday from Queensland Health, so it's probably right, that if you're in Brisbane and you're in the Brisbane greater area in your three-day lockdown, you have to wear a mask in your car, even if you're the only person in the car. Okay, all right, I didn't make the rule. So I think maybe you shouldn't need to, but it's not about me, is it? So anyway, love teaches me, amen, to have a measure of respect for that standard and do it, correct? I'm not rebellious against it. Love is a measure that teaches us about the truth of our identity to see ourselves as he does. So that helps stop the chipping away of our identity, of those things that I spoke to you about in the beginning, because those things in themselves are tiny little things. A couple of little demonic rewinds, a couple of little anxiety, nothing here nor there, yeah? A couple of little rules, but all added together, just chip, chip, chip. And I'm going to hand over to my brother. He's going to close. But just before I do, could you just put that last slide up, Sarah, please? I use it at work, and some of you will have seen it. I like it a lot because it's three-dimensional and, again, has no words. And for me, it's all about identity. So you're in here, you're in here, and then you're overall. So, love is a good measure. Amen? Not a spirit of foolishness. Do you like that? Anyway, I'm going to leave you on that, so be blessed. Amen.